Okay, welcome. This is Dr. Jason W. Morrison, Theologist, New South Wales, Australia. We've opened a can of worms here with this guard against loving money, because this is one thing that the Watchtower has proven that it does. It's incredible that as far as we know, well over $1.5 billion business organization that uses religion as a shop front, and it uses it very badly. I mean, there's carnage everywhere with their theology, is on here after begging. Look, you're talking about a $1.5 billion, right, organization asking people, the poor old day-to-day people that go to these meetings, for money, money, money. Now, they say we naturally want to have enough to eat. What sort of a statement's that? Suitable clothes to wear and a decent place to live. What has this got to do in any way, shape or form with guarding against or developing a love for money? What it's undermining is your capacity to be able to gain the money that you need. Now, they've got a picture here, and this is what they're saying. How some Laodiceans saw themselves and how Jehovah and Jesus saw them. This is irrelevant to what Jehovah only sees people through Christ, whether they're rich or poor, slave or free, bond or whatever. This idealism that grandizing yourself as being rich and then struggling as being poor is favored over being rich. No, 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 no. Life has different outcomes for people. There are going to be the poor and there are going to be the rich. Now, you can have this pompous attitude. I've met some very nasty, horrible, poor people. Bitter and twisted from what life's done to them. But I've met some very, very wonderful rich people. I'm sure there's nasty rich people and there's good poor people. There's nasty poor people and there's good rich people. The two are alike, exactly the same. So this is just, again, fanaticism. Absolute fanaticism. Now, we got up to the part down here, which I found very interesting. Jesus knew that his followers might be tempted to develop this love, the love for money. Well, what a lot of people don't realize is that Judas wasn't in the betrayal on his own. It was a conspiracy. Oh, well, let's not call it a conspiracy. It was a plan orchestrated by all the disciples. Judas was the scapegoat. A lot of people don't realize this. They haven't done the research to find out, but Judas was just a scapegoat, viewers. How do we know this? Well, just think for a minute. When the Roman soldiers and the Pharisees came with Judas to meet Christ, something very significant happened. Now, let me remind you. At the Last Supper, Jesus, I'm sure it was the Last Supper, correct me if I'm wrong, Jesus said to Peter, I think it was, whoever takes up the sword will die by the sword. Because Peter said, shall we bring our swords? And the Lord said, no. Now, when the Pharisees turned up to confront Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane with the Romans, and they said, who is Jesus or where is Jesus? And he said, I am. And they all fell backwards. You read the Gospels. The whole crowd fell backwards under the power of his word. I am, the same I am that spoke to Moses. Only this time he's put a little bit of extra kachinki in it, a little bit of extra divinity in it, and they've all fallen backwards, the whole lot, the Romans, the Pharisees, and probably even Judas. Now, something very interesting happened that gave us the clue, or gave me the clue and my associates the clue, to the fact that all the disciples knew that this was going to take place. They knew where Judas was. How? Because Peter drew his sword, which he wasn't supposed to have, and cut off the high priest's servant's ear. And Jesus had to put it back on again. And that was the clue. They knew who was coming. And they knew why they were coming. They just didn't expect Jesus to surrender to them. They thought Jesus, with all the power that he showed that he had, and all the reality of who they knew that he was, God manifest in the flesh, they didn't think that Jesus would allow them to take him away. They thought Jesus would just wave his hand and that would be the end of it. And one of the things that made them think that it was going to take place was when Jesus said, "I am," and they all fell backwards, and Peter and that would have thought, well, this is it, this is the time. And Peter cut off the high priest's servant's ear off, cut it right off, probably chinked him in the shoulder when he cut it off, unless he grabbed it and cut it off. I don't know. I think Peter swung to do greater damage than what he actually did. So it's interesting how a string of events can help you to see that the disciples knew that Judas was coming with the crowd. You can argue that. I don't care if you do or you don't. The facts are there, and that might help you to understand a little bit further the story. They ended up all running away and abandoning the Lord because of the confusion of it all. They did not think that the Lord Jesus Christ, with all the power that he showed and exhibited and everything that he did, would just allow them to take him away and crucify him. It was an incredible amount of confusion for the disciples and anxiety and everything that goes with it. Just the whole, they were just startled with the fact that the Lord allowed them to take him away. With all the power that he had, but he humbled himself even to the death of a cross, Hebrews says, and he did it for reasons that a lot of us don't want to face or understand. One being that God took accountability himself for the trouble and for all the sadness that this life brings. But we, in our ignorance and our limitedness in understanding the whole story of the Bible, we can't even work out that Adam ate because he loved Eve. Oh, Adam ate because he was some silly fool. No, Adam ate because he loved. That's why Jesus is the second Adam. He didn't want to leave Eve alone in a sin. He gave up all the glory that he had and ate so that he would be with the one he loved, Eve. God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. God didn't leave us to stay in sin. He came and died on the cross himself and said, "Look, you put me on the cross, you crucify me. Well, the stake, if you're a Jehovah Witness, what difference does it make? You can crucify me. You can punish me. You can kill me. I'm taking accountability and responsibility for all of this, and I want the world to know it and the world to see it, that I love you." And we killed him. You might not have been there, but we killed him because he loved us and he allowed us to do it. What a wonderful God. Oh, back to the subject. Let's get back to the subject, shall we? No one can slave for two masters. That's a load of rubbish. I know Jesus said it, but you can. You can have a damn good job, a good career, even a great, wonderful business, and still serve God. Jesus said, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will stick to the one and despise the other.
And the Jehovah Witnesses use the word, you cannot slave for God and for riches. Well, you can. And Jesus knew they could, because he said, give to Caesar what is Caesar's and to God what is God's. So the Lord put it in a right perspective. You give to Caesar what is Caesar's, you have those priorities right. You give to God what is God's, you have those priorities right. A person who worships Jehovah while also spending excessive time and effort trying to gain this world's riches. Some people have to work two jobs. Some people are going to have to put more time into their priorities, their life priorities, than what they'll ever be able to serving Jehovah. And this comes back, viewers, to where you are in your life. If you're not a religious leader, if you're not on a wage working for the organization, or wherever you're at, you've got to get your priorities right. I know many, many males, physically and mentally well, that have suffered from spiritual passivity, spiritual ideals that have caused them to be passive and stopped them from going out in their masculinity and having a job, because they're bound up in this undermining mentality that a person who worships Jehovah while also spending excessive time and effort trying to gain this world's riches would, in a sense. This is what these religious organizations don't realize is, my goodness, how psychologically undermining this is for a young person, even an old person. I know men that had tremendous businesses and threw it all away in pursuit of trying to get right with Jehovah and all the rest of it, and it was destructive. It destroyed them. There's a spiritual passivity that holds people down like an anchor, because they've come to this place where they've got to put the Lord their God first to be right with him. And it's taken away their... Now, this isn't all. I'm talking about the ones that are suffering from this passivity, religious passivity. And it stops them from getting out and doing what they're supposed to do to produce in life. The Lord said, get out and be fruitful, didn't he? He didn't say, wander around and prove that you love me and serve me. He said, get out and be fruitful. The watchtower is not going to tell you this, because they don't believe in being skilled, and unless it's for their convenience, their lawyers and all these other people. You have every right to be completely and thoroughly skilled to produce as much money as you can in the life that you have. So they say, a person who worships Jehovah while also spending excessive time and effort trying to gain this world's riches, could that be while trying to make an income, would in a sense be trying to serve two masters. What they're doing here is twisting religious devotion with life's priorities. They're twisting religious devotion with life's priorities, and that causes psychological damage. I know it does, because I've had to help many young men try and get motivated to get to work, and the main part of it is convincing them that you don't have to put the Lord your God before all else. No, you don't. That's nonsense. We have priorities in life, and we have to stand up to those priorities, and everything else will follow. The Lord's not intimidated by us trying to have a well-ordered life. And he would not be giving Jehovah exclusive devotion. See, I'm telling you, I'm telling you as best as I can. This is causing in this generation, for the people that listen, a terrible undermining of the motivation and inspiration they need to have to get out and make a proper living for themselves. Let's carry on, shall we? Paragraph 6. Well, hang on, have we finished here? Is there something I want to share from here? A person who worships Jehovah while spending excessive time and effort trying to gain this world's riches would, in a sense, be trying to serve two masters. Well, either you're serving two masters or you're not. I want to say this again. Producing money as part of your ability and priority in life to meet needs and to be able to give you a life excess, exceedingly abundantly above all you could ask or think, is not wrong. If you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, that he died on the cross, was buried and rose again for the forgiveness of your sins, Jesus said you don't have to worry no more. Worry about what? Worry about your relationship with God. It's done. It's right. In him, it's done. This is all, really, it's taken out of context. These are people that don't even think of Jehovah. Their God is their riches. So there's a balance. You believe in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you make as much money as you can for yourself and for your family, and you put it wherever you want to put it and spend it. I want to just share a video of how these Jehovah's Witness leaders undermine education, and then I'll join you back here for paragraph 6. This is Winston of the Watchtower Examination Channel. Do subscribe.
In video 253, I was seriously concerned about the Watchtower's manipulation of the scriptures in an effort to manipulate Watchtower members into a senseless form of submission to the elders. There was one comment made by Mr. Stephen Lett that I did not comment on, and it was not because the importance of it slipped me, but because I did not want to divert from the theme of that video. But I really should not allow him to get away with this.
Notice, we are told to be obedient. Clearly, this means that we're supposed to comply with or obey what they tell us. Of course, that would be with a proviso, unless they tell us to do something that is unscriptural. And of course, that would be extremely rare.
Is he serious? That should not come from any organization that admits many beliefs clarified. Erroneous beliefs that have been changed reflect things that elders would admonish members to do that are now, admittedly, not scriptural. Heartlessly shunning relatives, even your own children, is something elders are currently encouraging members to do, and that is not scriptural. Elders would currently encourage members to hate former members, in particular the ones who still believe in God and still believe in the scriptures, but reject the Watchtower organization and will speak against it. The elders would, following the dictate of the governing body, describe that as badness and encourage witnesses to hate those former members, describing them as enemies of God.
Some apostates profess to know and serve God, but they reject teachings or requirements set out in His Word. Others claim to believe the Bible, but they reject Jehovah's organization and actively try to hinder its work. When they deliberately choose such badness, after knowing what is right, when the bad becomes so ingrained that it is an inseparable part of their makeup, then a Christian must hate, in the biblical sense of the word, those who have inseparably attached themselves to the badness. True Christians share Jehovah's feelings towards such apostates. They are not curious about apostate ideas. On the contrary, they feel a loathing toward those who have made themselves God's enemies.
Is that scriptural, Mr. Litt? Note that that was printed in their public edition of the Watchtower magazine. They were not shy about putting it out there. Well, I watched an older video with Mr. Litt, and again, had to wonder if he is to be taken seriously. From his discussion of the Bible in the August 2018 Watchtower broadcast, I did not really take pleasure in calling him a simpleton, but he has confirmed in this video that indeed he is. And the saddest part is that he is presenting himself to Jehovah's Witness young people as an example to be emulated.
Personally, I am so thankful to Jehovah that positive peer pressure was put on me to enter the Pioneer Ministry right out of high school. What a blessing and a protection it was to enter the regular pioneer work at age 17 and to be able to go to Bethel at 18. Even though there was considerable worldly pressure put on me to pursue university education, I am so happy that with Jehovah's help, I decided to build my future with Jehovah.
And this is apparently the end result of having been educated at Bethel.
Or one more example, what if he had decided to become a doctor? He could cure sick people, even raise the dead.
Dear Mr. Litt, you may find this hard to believe, but Jesus did heal the sick and raise the dead, even though he was not a doctor. And doctors, Mr. Litt, do not have power to raise the dead.
Can you imagine how much he could have charged rich people to raise their dead loved ones? But Jesus pursued none of these careers. Why?
Dear Watchtower members, Jesus came to earth with one particular mission, to save his people from their sin by dying for them. You cannot do that. Jesus also did not go to a school like Gilead and did not get elected to some governing body of an organization like the Watchtower. And please point out to Mr. Litt that Jesus did not get married and start a family, and ask if he followed that example of Jesus. There is a reason that Paul instructed at 1 Timothy 3:6 that a bishop should never be a novice. Once again, another governing body member gave another testimony about an unnamed person. This unnamed person is presented as an example for young people to emulate.
That makes me think of the comments of a well-adjusted teenage brother whom we served while in the circuit work many years ago. This young brother went straight into the regular pioneer work out of high school, and I asked him why he did so. He explained that he knew he could have gotten a full-time secular job and bought a new car for himself, but he reasoned that in a few years, that car would rust out and break down, and he would have nothing.
How many years would it take for a car to rust down to nothing? How many career professionals end up with nothing if their car depreciates? Besides, how many working people allow a car to rust down to nothing before any thought of replacing it with a new one? Biggest question, how many simpletons do you find out there who think like this unnamed person? Probably someone who would qualify to become a member of the Watchtower's governing body.
But he knew that he could go into the pioneer work and build a close relationship with Jehovah, and perhaps even find an honest-hearted person and be able to teach that one the truth, and he knew that would last forever. Now that is some wise thinking on the part of that young brother. And today, that brother has a beautiful Christian wife and several spiritual children, and he is serving as a fine elder.
I certainly hope that young Jehovah's Witnesses really do not believe it is the ideal not to go to college to qualify themselves, then get married with several children, thinking that the crowning act of that sacrifice is becoming an elder. Take it from someone who has very serious regrets about not going to college. Me. If this gospel of the Watchtower Kingdom is the good news for their young people, I feel truly sorry for them. The saddest part for me is that some persons never learn.
I did not have a career. I didn't go to college because the end was so close. There was no need. The new world would be here.
I was a senior in high school, and the circuit overseer, which is a traveling minister, advised me that it's best for you to quit school and go into full-time pioneer work because the world is going to end in 1975.
Clearly, this means that we're supposed to comply with or obey what they tell us. Of course, that would be with a proviso, unless they tell us to do something that is unscriptural. And of course, that would be extremely rare.
Those who fail to learn from history are bound to repeat it. I did not know how to react when, after watching that clip by Mr. Litt, I was to then see him read this scripture.
Jehovah tells us there, the one walking with the wise will become wise, but the one who has dealings with the stupid will fare badly.
May the grace of the Lord Jesus.
I feel like I haven't talked about Jehovah's Witnesses' stance on college lately, so it's long past time. Jehovah's Witnesses have a hierarchical structure with a governing body at the very top. There are 8 governing body members. Some are weirder than others, and each one seems to have his pet subject he likes to talk about. The one we'll be taking a look at today is Toni Morris. He has some really weird pet subjects he likes hitting. So let's take a look. Let's get into it. Before we get into the clip, let me just give you a little background on this dude. He wasn't always a Jehovah's Witness, which is interesting because typically the people who make it furthest up the hierarchy are people who were born into the religion, people who have a family history in the religion. But this dude was actually in the Vietnam back in the 60s and 70s. And here's another little fun fact for you. He's my mom's favorite governing body member. Back when I was in the religion, the governing body was largely hidden from public view. I didn't even know who they were, but in recent years, they've made a concerted effort to come out in the public eye. Not sure if that's been a good thing or a bad thing for them, but I will say this. Toni Morris does not belong in the public eye. He has a tendency to say really stupid stuff. As I said, preventing people from pursuing higher education is one of his pet subjects, but he's got a couple of other pet subjects that he likes addressing at random times. Probably his most famous subject to talk about is how the have taken over the fashion industry and made tight pants popular because they like to see other men wearing them. Now, if you're a Jehovah's Witness and your suit is a little too tight, you can be reprimanded for it. It's even made a cameo appearance in their Caleb and Sophia videos.
Before you go in the ministry, there's a few things we need to go over. First, we must learn the 3 P's.
The 3 P's?
Yes. Preparation, personal appearance, and proper behavior. Now that you are well prepared, it's time to talk about personal appearance. Our clothes fit well, but not too well.
He's also tried to draw an entirely too vivid picture of what Armageddon will be like, drawing from his experiences in Vietnam. The more this guy talks, the more damage he does to the religion's reputation. Actually, he's probably my mom's favorite governing body member because he was in Vietnam. She was in the military during Vietnam too. She probably feels like she can relate to him for that reason. Of course, my mom wasn't a Jehovah's Witness at the time. Military service is forbidden in the religion. Anyways, let's take a look at what old Toni Morris has to say about higher education.
Sometimes people will say, well, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses are against education. Well, that's ridiculous. We're not against education. We are pro-education. It's just that we are selective with who does the educating. We promote divine education. We believe it to be superior because it leads to everlasting life.
That's one of the most skillful propagandistic twists on it I've ever heard in my life. They're pro-education, they're just anti-college. They're in favor of their education, which is to say they want people to learn about Jehovah through them instead of going to college. Let's continue.
So, with schools of higher education, in many of their curriculums, and if you know anything about it, maybe some of you have been, do they not have Philosophy 1 and Philosophy 2? It doesn't matter what you're going to major in. And they start you off there. You'd be going for another thing, but you have Philosophy 1, you have Philosophy 2. And then all of a sudden it gets in there, and the intellectual gripping of the mind, very hard to recover from.
I'm sorry? What was that? Are you saying that thinking critically is hard to recover from? What a crazy thing to say. Intellectualism is hard to recover from. I really don't even know what to say about that one. It kind of speaks for itself.
I've seen this so many times, and we could tell you so many horror stories, and the parents are all distraught. Well, you put them there. I remember one mother, I talked to her son. He went to Harvard, and we were in New England. He became an evolutionist. Raised in the truth. Mom couldn't believe it, but I got him to tell me what he really thought. She was devastated. Well, you let him go there. And this real bright professor got a hold of him. Hard to believe.
For only $69 a month for the first 6 months, not only do you get our fastest...
I know my audience is a mix of religious and non-religious people alike, but we all came together with the same goal, exposing destructive cults. But I feel like I need to take a stand on this one. Evolution is a fact. For anybody who's taken 7th grade science class, you'll already know this, but I know there are some people who were out sick that day, so let me break it down a little bit. A scientific theory is a large collection of facts that describes the way something works in great detail, and we derive laws from theories. So we have the theory of relativity. The fact that it's labeled as a theory isn't a point against it, it's a point in its favor. It means that it's on such solid footing in the scientific community that we can derive universal laws from it, like the law of gravity. The theory of relativity is composed of a bunch of supporting facts, like the fact that light near a large gravitational bodies will curve toward it, or the fact that things in motion experience time at a different rate than things that are stationary. Einstein took these facts and compiled them together, created a hypothesis, and tested the hypothesis over and over again. Some of the hypotheses failed, so he marked them out and continued on. When he came up with something absolutely rock solid, he came up with a way to disprove it. That's called falsifiability. It passed those tests too. Now that we have a comprehensive theory, which is a description of the facts we observe, we can derive laws from it. It's no different with the theory of evolution. We have a billion supporting facts and sub-theories. Natural selection, gene duplication, mutations, on and on. Each of these observable phenomena come together in a massive umbrella called the theory of evolution. And now we can derive laws from it. We can make predictions based on it, which we've done, and it's falsifiable. If we found a rabbit in the Precambrian era, it would disprove evolution. If we could show that mutations don't occur, it would disprove evolution. If we could prove that mutations aren't passed down, it would disprove it. The kid became a quote-unquote evolutionist because the facts outweigh the indoctrination. Jehovah's Witnesses don't want people going to college because they know as soon as they do, they'll find out all the many ways they've been lied to since they were children. Let's continue.
Another false refuge, and you parent and the individual child have to work out your own salvation with God. This higher education and this press for higher education, and when the motive is salary and the idea of having the means to get that dream house, see, you got a problem.
So here he's saying, you know, you have to work out your own salvation. Not saying you won't make it through Armageddon if you go to college, but you won't make it through Armageddon. If you go to college because you want to be able to provide for yourself, you've got a problem. Weirdly, there are a disproportionate number of Jehovah's Witnesses who work as window cleaners. It's uncanny. I mean, I guess it makes sense. You tell people not to get a higher education because you don't want to risk them learning how completely full of you are, and they're going to have to find another way to survive. That's what happens. Window cleaning is a relatively low-skilled, decent-paying job. So sometimes you'll find a congregation where one person owns a window cleaning company, and they'll have contracts with every major company in a city, and all the adult male Jehovah's Witnesses in the congregation will work with them cleaning windows. It's honest work. I can't fault them for that. But one of the keys to keeping people subjugated and indoctrinated is to limit how much outside information they're exposed to. Window cleaning is honestly the perfect setup. You don't have to talk to your coworkers if you don't want to. You're both there to do a job. You know how to do it. No communication necessary. Just on the off chance one of them isn't a Jehovah's Witness. But in areas where they are all Jehovah's Witnesses, it's even better. You're surrounded by like-minded people 24/7. Get up in the morning, read the daily text with your family, go to work with other Jehovah's Witnesses, come home and study with the family, go to bed. It's a perfect echo chamber. The only potential pitfall is the internet or school. If they can limit access to those two things, then you've got them for life. Based on how the religion operates, sometimes it's honestly surprising that anybody finds their way out. But every now and then I hear stories from people who tell me they were in the religion for 50 years. They're married and they have grandchildren in the religion now. Everybody they've talked to or worked with over their entire lifetime has been linked to the religion. They didn't even realize there was this type of pushback against their religion until the moment they got on the internet and discovered it. And they can't talk to anybody around them because they're surrounded. Their social networks, their friend groups, their jobs, everything is tied into the religion. And if they reveal that they don't believe it anymore, they will lose everything. It isn't about the risk of losing everything. They will. End of story. They will have the rug pulled out from under them, and it's over. As time goes on, you can see the governing body of Jehovah's Witnesses locking into their positions deeper and deeper, isolating members more and more, caring more and more about locking the current members, and more importantly, their children, into the religion permanently. Let's continue.
So, all we're saying is that what you choose to do, they need to learn something. They need to learn thinking ability, learn how to take care of their wife and their family. But what I don't appreciate hearing, and I heard this in different parts of the country, not saying I heard it here, you need a degree. I don't care what they said or this or that. You need a degree. Well, my answer to that would be what they really need is a good name with God. That's what they need. And we're not going to apologize, because there's no need to, for encouraging our young people in this organization to reach out for full-time service. That would be absurd and offensive to God. We're going to encourage that. We think that's a great life for our young people.
The goal here is to prevent people from going to college. Instead, have them knock on doors full time. That doesn't bring in any money. How do you even survive? I hear the window cleaning business is thriving right now. Actually, the congregation I went to when I was little was in a relatively nice area, so there were a couple of elders with PhDs. One of them was a dentist of some sort. He had a lab in his basement and he would manufacture dentures for people, which is an extremely complex job as it turns out. It isn't as simple and straightforward as you'd think. Another elder in my congregation used to be an artist. He sold his last painting for like $100,000. He was well on his way to being famous. He was very skilled. He gave it all up. He refuses to even sketch now because he doesn't want the love of art to overtake him. He gave up a genuinely lucrative career as an artist, something that people aspire to become an office cleaner. He and his wife were pioneers in the religion and would go around from office to office cleaning up after people. But the most popular job in my congregation was to work for a family who owned a POS company. They serviced every cash register in a 100-mile radius. They provided cash registers and POS systems to every business around. They employed a lot of the kids in the congregation to work for them. Again, a job that doesn't require a college education, but it was on the higher end of unskilled. It still takes skill and knowledge to do that kind of thing, but you can learn it without going to college. Jehovah's Witnesses seem to find ways to survive, even when they're cut off at the knees, by being told not to go to college. And of course, the governing body doesn't care. They've got a ton of money. They're sitting pretty in their cult compound, Bethel. They don't have a care in the world, and they've got a legion of 8.5 million people who follow their every direction. Anyways, that's all I've got for you. If you like what I do and you want to make sure I can continue to do it, you can support me in a few ways. First, you can support me on Patreon. That's probably the best way. But if you want to get something back for your support, you can check out my Teespring. I'm trying to make a shirt.
So what's a Jehovah's Witness supposed to do? Obviously, by the sound of it, they're supposed to just learn about spirituality. Let me tell you something. At the age of 9, I had a paper run at West Gosford.
whilst going to school. Finished school. Got a job in the quarry where they made bricks. Left that. Got a job at the abattoirs and became a professional slaughterman. Left that. Did a bricklaying apprenticeship. Became a professional bricklayer. Had a break from that. Became a swim teacher and swim coach. Learned how to make cedar blinds. So many different things you can learn. Learned how to do videography for weddings and marriages and stuff. Became a theologist at university level. Got a bachelor's, master's, doctorate. I'm doing a PhD. What's wrong with education? It hasn't affected my relationship with God at all. Not one bit. I've got a business now that's a bricklaying business, and I help other bricklayers as well and do my theologist work when it's going to be worth it. But you can be skilled. You can have a trade. You can have a business and be a successful person now, as a religious person. Now, I think it's only fair to the Jehovah's Witnesses that we mention these two people that I can think of. Or actually, I'm just going to look up celebrities that are Jehovah's Witnesses. So let's have a look at the most famous Jehovah's Witnesses, and you see and ask yourself, why didn't the governing body step in here?
Jehovah's Witnesses, and finally I see.
So should you or shouldn't you be qualified? I think it's a personal decision. I don't think it's something that the Watchtower should decide for people. There's many, many famous people, well-qualified people that have made fantastic contributions in this world by their skills. So I don't know what sort of a Jehovah's Witness you are or anything like that. You need to be as qualified as you can be. If not to be a religious leader or elder or whatever you call it on a wage, if it's not that, then get the best qualifications you can in life so that your life is fruitful, like Venus Williams, like Prince, like Michael Jackson, like these other actors and people that decided that a career was going to have no detrimental effect on their contribution to the religious aspect of their life, as it were. Well, we didn't get far, did we? That's why I'm not much good at these. I'm asking you, a person who worships Jehovah while also spending excessive time and effort trying to gain this world's riches would, in a sense, be trying to serve two masters. That's psychologically, that is a deep, psychologically damaging passage, viewers. That really is something that would put such a bend on a person's mind and
conflict as to, do I forge forward in a career clear of conscience and not have to worry about whether I'm right with God or not? Or if I go forward with a career, is it going to conflict with my relationship with God? These are the serious things that we need to find peace with, because you can serve God and work as much as you need to provide for yourself and for your family, not at the bottom of the rung, not in a way that's going to just put crumbs on the table, but in a way that's going to put turkey and all other stuff on the table and enable you to help people in a way that otherwise wouldn't allow you to do that. So for now, this is Dr. Jason W. Morrison, theologist. My goodness me, we still haven't got out of this, but we will in the next one. We'll try and move on to paragraph 6. I hope you're going to be there with me as we do it. Bye for now. Yeah, Dr. Jason Morrison, theologist again. I just want to say thank you for watching the videos, and I hope you got plenty of self-rediscovery and freedom out of it. If you watched it on YouTube, please share or like, maybe even comment. If you watched it on Facebook, like, comment, share. But most of all, get out and live. This isn't a rehearsal. You've got a one-off life. Don't let your loyalty and your faithfulness blind you to the life that you should be experiencing. Till the next video, thank you for watching, and bye for now.